On January 12, 2010, a devastating 7.0 earthquake struck the island of Haiti, the most damaging earthquake to hit the island in 200 years. An estimated 200,000 people have lost their lives. 1.5 million are now homeless. To date, the full impact of the earthquake has not been assessed. What do we know about this island called Haiti? What do we know about Haiti? Still numb from the news of this tragic disaster, watching CNN and the clips of the injured and dead bodies strewn about the streets of Haiti, I could not believe what I was hearing about my country. From the United States to SVG, these are the things the news media and some people seem to know about Haiti.
And you know, Christy, something happened a long time ago in Haiti, and people may not want to talk about it. They were under the heel of the French, Napoleon III and whatever. And they got together and swore a pact to the devil. They said, we will serve you if you'll get us free from the French. Mm. True story. And so the devil said, okay, it's a deal. And they kicked the French out. You know, the Haitians revolted and got themselves free. But ever since, they have been cursed by one thing after the other, desperately poor. That island of Hispaniola is one island. Mm-hmm. It's cut down the middle. On the one side is Haiti, on the other side is the Dominican Republic. Dominican Republic is prosperous, mm-hmm. healthy, full of resorts, etc. Haiti is in desperate poverty. Same island.
We were told, and you heard it in the reports, that it's not very well developed, and that many of the houses were destroyed because they were not earthquake proof. And that's about all we knew about Haiti before.
When I reached in Haiti, it was a lamentable situation. What media is showing you is not the real picture of the reality. So when you reach on the ground, you will see what is reality.
And they love to present scenes like Vodou, for example. Even taking Vodou out of the real context of what does it mean. Until now, even after the earthquake, when you were seeing the CNN or all the other, they didn't know what to say because they were so bad informed or so misinformed about Haiti that the journalists who were covering it did a very bad role, a very bad play. They did not knew much what to say.
Has lots of different religion, as in the Voodoo religion. That is the main religion in Haiti. So this could be all the cause of that Voodooism and all kind of stuff, so treating people badly. So when you curse some people, it will come back to you. So this is what they get from cursing other people. If you, most of the time when you go on the internet, right? That's the first thing, most of the time the first thing right to pop up. In religion, you say about the Voodooism. Voodoo is something that people curse you. If they don't like you, they put voodoo on you, as people say. They go blight you. So if they blight you, it will come back around to you. So that's what Haiti is mainly based on. Because if you go to the history, you will see that voodoo is stuck in Haiti. Chile have a earthquake caused a tsunami, and it is so much stronger than the one in Haiti, and it would not cause so many deaths and so many damages. But the one in Little Haiti would kill thousands of people. Why would that happen? I don't believe that they're always doing it, but if you have 100% of the people in Haiti, you would say 97% of them is doing it. Saint Vincent has done a lot of wrong things, plenty of things that we have done. From small to the government to the little people on the streets, we have done plenty of wrong.
So should we call that voodoo too, the wrong that Vincentians do?
We won't call it voodoo, some people call it susu.
They believe in too much obia. One and all she talk about is obia, that she do her mad. I was never there, but I heard about it, that they do it plenty over there. Yes, and maybe that's why plenty disaster happening to them.
Everybody.
Yes. Well, from what I heard, they practice more obia. From one of my friends who had an Haitian friend. Yes.
I get to hear in the all the time the white people and was fighting against the black people, and the black people and then couldn't go with them because them have gone on the. I get to hear they fighting with stick and stone and all this. I still see it over picture. It's happening, and that the only how they could conquer them, get to the devil. I don't know how they get to him, but they get to him. I think there's a part of limbo to me, really. Eh? There's a part of hell for me. Because why they, sometimes I'm wondering why they should have the name Haiti. So everything they hate come back to them. The Haitians come back to them. They're a bad nation. Those people of the father get from since I you, they don't live to God. They more live to the devil. And I feel this the reason why the meeting so much a thing happening to them. And we only could pray to God for them. We cannot help them because we are that kind of still a small country, but what we give them. But different to that, I needed to change their life wrong to God.
I say kill the fucking motherfucking Haitians. That is why I say, kill the fucking motherfucking Haitians. You know why? They believe in voodoo, African science. So highly Selassie, I must murder them with natural fucking technology.
What you have just seen and heard are some of the myths that have historically plagued Haiti. That something as tragic as a natural disaster could be attributed to voodoo and the work of the devil saddens and angers me as a Haitian woman. I wondered if these sentiments and misconceptions were universal, and I was determined to find out. I started recording the news reports and conversations I had with people here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines.
We have a proverb in Africa who say that the killer of a lion will always be a great man. You need a lion to tell his own story. That means Asian people have to tell their own story.
And I think before I say anything, I would like to address one thing that I heard tonight.
Please.
About how the pact with the devil made it possible for Haiti to suffer the way it is. I would like the whole world to know, America especially, that the independence of Haiti, when the slave rose up against the French and defeated the French army, powerful army, the U.S. was able to gain the Louisiana Territory for $15 million. That's 3 cents an acre. That's 13 states west of the Mississippi that the Haitian slaves revolt in Haiti provided America. Also, the revolt of the rebels in Haiti allowed Latin America to be free. It's from Haiti that Simon Bolivar left with men, boats, to go deliver Gran Colombia and the rest of South America. So, what pact the Haitian made with the devil has helped the United States become what it is.
Always been interested in the way the history of my people has been written, not only by Haitians but outsiders. And history, as they say, is his story. I'd like to do a documentary from the perspective of a Haitian, you know, someone who, even though has lived in the diaspora, I still have my roots, I still have my connection. So I'd like to tell our story.
Our story, a human story that can be told not only by me, a Haitian, but from multiple perspectives.
My sentiments have really been ones of despair, because Haiti has had such a troubled history, you know, after having such a magnificent start with securing their own independence through battle in the early 1800s. You know, since then they've had such a troubled history. And to see something like this happen, it's a tragedy that Haiti couldn't afford.
It's not the fact that if somebody is doing what is not upright in God's sight, that God has to destroy a nation like that. I don't think that God destroyed Haiti. Probably the countries of great power oppress us too much. Probably God used that opportunity to send a message that to let Haiti go free for a rebirth, for a new beginning. I don't see that as evil.
When you hear of all the disasters in Haiti and people say it's a result of the people, why this is happening. It's more a result of where Haiti is and the topography of the country, why we have so many disasters in Haiti. But for people to equate that to the lifestyle that the people live is ridiculous. Haiti is a rich civilization that has really contributed a lot to this hemisphere. And that is the perspective from which we should see Haiti.
Historical connection, it would come in the 1790s. You know, the Haitian Revolution started in 1791, in August 1791, and in 1795 they had a rebellion with the Garifuna people here. So that connection with the French, and the French was the backers of those people too, and even in St. Lucia, the French was stirring up rebellion against the British forces. So all that is a link. And in Grenada too, they had Julian Fedon in 1795. So it was a link with the French people from Haiti, St. Lucia, St. Vincent, Grenada. It was one cause, you know. It was liberty, freedom, justice for all that. That was like the motto. So it was connected with the history from the past too.
The first sister of African nations in 1804. You know, Napoleon army was one of the greatest. And the Haitian people lead by Toussaint Louverture. So it gave hope to African nation, Republic Democratique du Congo, where Belge left suddenly without any infrastructure, without any school. Then, fortunately that, Haitian people went back home and helped to build over African countries. And we are very grateful for that. So when we say Haiti, it's come in my mind, another part of us some way. Yes.
H to the A to the I to the T to the I, live or die. It's nothing but a dark side. Fuji's on the mic, yeah, yeah. Your refugees on the mic. Oh yeah, oh yeah. H to the A.
The shame that Haiti brought and the Western world, Western society, white supremacy. You know, most likely, like many other places that brought resistance against colonialism, white supremacy, the kind of propaganda that was spread about, like for example, Ethiopia and His Majesty, I think it is misrepresented, the history that we got about Haiti. Most of the things we hear about Haiti is things like voodoo, obia, and paint a negative light of the Haitian people. And most people, because of being colonized, would really accept that version, right? But if we go into the authenticity of the culture of the people, we would see it is very African. And as a Rasta man and as a man that defend and love Africa, I would look at Haiti from that perspective.
History, you hypocrites, so what we gonna do? But don't is only if the man says that it's true. So hip, hip, load my lip as I rip for the real tip of a righteous situation. Interpretation of degradation, your race relation, and education, segregation, emancipation, a capitalization, integration, not separation.
Why is Haiti such a malign nation?
You cannot be the richest country once in the Western Hemisphere and then know you are the poorest country. No, in the Western Hemisphere. I think there's something wrong about that math. I think news, media, whatever, radio station, newspapers, whatever might be the case, I don't think they are telling us the truth. You understand me? They show us for years, poverty in Haiti, right? I don't think Haiti is all about poverty. They show us what they want to show us. But I think Haiti in itself is a better country than we are seeing on television or in newspapers. You understand? And I think they're not telling us the truth politically.
I took a team from the Caribbean and we were organizing the election when President Aristide came back. But in the process of having the consultation with the political parties, I understood that there were almost 100 political parties in Haiti. Haiti needs a new constitution because Haiti has swung from dictatorship to democratic chaos.
H to the A to the I to the T to the I, live or die. It's nothing but a dark side. Fuji's on the mic, yeah, yeah. Your refugees on the mic, oh yeah, oh yeah. H to the A to the I to the T to the I, live or die. It's nothing but a dark side. Fuji's on the mic, yeah, yeah. Your refugees on the mic, oh yeah, oh yeah. If you wanna snap, snap. If you wanna crack, crack. If you wanna shoot, give me a second so I can lay flat.
What is the political history of Haiti's relations to St. Vincent and other nations of the world?
In 1795, a group of Asian named Negros Frances have been exiled from Haiti to Honduras in Trujillo. And 2 years later, in 1797, a group of the Caribbean from St. Vincent and the Grenadines, named the Black Caribs, were also deported to Honduras, but to the coast of, to the island of Rotan. But very soon after their arrival in Rotan, they've been incorporated to the Spanish milice, which was in Trujillo. This is where they met with those Negros Frances. They are those people that we forget, unfortunately, but that have a so important role in the history of the Caribbean, in the independence of Caribbean islands, but also South America countries. Those same Haitian and some of those Black Caribs were then incorporated to Bolivar milices to go and conquer the independence of South America.
The word Haiti has a lot of meaning for the Latin American people, and in particular for Venezuelans. Haiti is l'ouverture. Haiti is Dessalines. Haiti is pétion. Haiti means fight for independence and the emancipation of the African slaves and Latin American countries. In the history books of Venezuela and the entire Latin America, when speaking about Haiti, one always refers to the fight for independence and the emancipation. We are very grateful to Haiti. In 1916, while Simon Bolivar was in Haiti requesting assistance from President Pétion, Haiti gave us 6,000 rifles, 5 large sailing ships with which we carried the generals, the officials, and many of the soldiers who finally acquired the independence of our territory and who permitted us to move forward to liberate the entire America. Haiti's tragedy had an impact on all of us. We felt the earthquake that destroyed Port-au-Prince and the main cities of Haiti as a tragedy for all Latin American people. Today, we feel that the Haitian people need the solidarity of everybody, but mainly the respect of their sovereignty and dignity as a nation. And as Venezuelans, as Latin American people, as a worthy product of the native land of Simon Bolivar and friends of the people of Alexandre Pétion, we are ready to help the Haitian people not only to overcome that huge tragedy provoked by the 12th of January earthquake, but also to support the reconstruction within the respect of their dignity as a people and their sovereignty as an independent republic.
We have excellent relations with Haiti. Haiti is a member of CARICOM. We share, objectively speaking, a context of being developing countries in the front yard or the backyard, depending on which version you take, of the most powerful empire that has ever existed, the American Empire. So there are a lot of commonalities. Cooperation between our two countries takes place within the multilateral context of CARICOM. We work together with Venezuela and other countries in the region, in the Petrocarib project, spearheaded largely by Venezuela, but of course involved in Cuba and other countries of the ALBA.
How have these nations responded to the earthquake's devastation of Haiti?
This is very important because we have been there, fully there, since 1998. As a matter of fact, when the earthquake happened, we have around 600 Cuban cooperants in Haiti. Of them, 400 were doctors, and all the others were in different areas. We have consistently been helping Haiti, even to help erase the illiteracy. We have this Cuban method called Yes, I Can Do It. And many in Creole and also in French. And many of them, even today, after the earthquake, they are learning to read and write through this method. So Cuba, the Cuban cooperants happened to be there when everything happened. And they were the first one to go and help the people from Haiti.
So far, we have made a contribution of 63,344 US dollars. So far from St. Vincent, and that money has gone all up to Geneva. We told them in Geneva that we wanted this money to go towards shelter, 63,344.95. That's the figure, US dollars. And our count, just yesterday, we received $30,000 from Scotia Bank to go towards the fund. So when that fund raises again, we will make another drawdown and make another contribution to Haiti. What the Red Cross has been doing, especially in the case of Haiti, but because of the roads have been damaged and all of that, you would not have a lot of commerce out of Port-au-Prince. So the Red Cross have been working with them. So the stuff when it goes down, so the Red Cross underground and in the villages, in the communities, they are aware as to who is supposed to receive what. To feed all these people in Haiti is not an easy task. Because you will see down the road, seven lines, to quote him, seven lines abreast. And it's down the road for a good mile and a half.
I noticed that President Preval has made the point that really they don't need quote unquote food. What they really need is the assistance to help to grow the food in Haiti, help to develop the Haitian economy. And that is, in my judgment, a sensible approach. It's a straightforward but quite sensible approach.
But the difficulty is the impoverishedness of Haiti, simply because too much of the arable lands in Haiti are owned by too few people. Before Haiti can do anything, there must be a serious land reformation program.
The people have destroyed the land, and the governments and the people have destroyed the land, and the land needs to be restored. There needs to be serious soil conservation and reafforestation of Haiti if it is to get anywhere.
I know President Preval at CARICOM, and I saw the report of what he stated at CARICOM. He made a complaint that the Haitian government was not receiving the assistance directly. That a lot of assistance was coming to NGOs handpicked by the donors, particularly the Americans and the French, the Europeans. And of course, a lot of the money was being put towards quote-unquote security, maintaining the American military personnel in Haiti.
Time and time again, we see the American presence in Haiti. One wonders, what exactly are they doing there? Obviously, with President Obama sending 10,000 military personnel several days after the earthquake, one could only surmise they are there to occupy Haiti again.
We have to understand and don't hark back to all of this nonsense about colonialism and reactivation. I don't go for that. If the Marines are rebuilding the Haitian port with their own money and doing and giving it as a job to people, it's fine. So you have to decide sometimes where you are with certain kinds of development, how you can get the things on the ground. Because if the Americans rebuild the port of Port-au-Prince and you can get in your supplies, the Americans will one day leave.
Our American friends are excellent at doing the military business. They do not have as good a record in doing the developmental and nation-building business. We have seen that in several countries throughout the world. This is not to throw smoke in their eyes in relation to their generosity and the heartfelt commitment of President Obama, not to throw any cold water and all of that. It's just that the structures in the U.S., the way they deliver the aid in circumstances like what we have seen in Haiti, they tend to look at their own institutional needs and are not as sufficiently sensitive to the needs on the ground.
What are Haiti's needs? How will those needs impact Haiti, its Caribbean neighbors, and the international community?
So after the earthquake, what I thought, okay, it is very hard for the Haitian people. What I kept in mind is that I want to visit the country maybe next year, maybe end of this year. What we like to do is, because we like traveling, we usually don't travel to resorts, something like that. So like here we stayed with more or less people who live on this island and try to spend money with the natives, because then I can be sure that the money I give become to the natives and not to anybody holding a resort who is a manager in the States or whatever. And this is what I think I can do to give help, not only with money, money is necessary, but also that they know that they are not forgotten.
A big part of Haiti's tragedy to me is the destruction of the environment that has happened over the years. So what I would like to see is, you know, big oil companies and that need positive credits, that need good carbon credits to say, I'm going to invest in replanting Haiti, you know. So I think, you know, companies with a lot of money who by their very nature, affect the environment in a negative way. I think they should be some of the leaders in terms of taking Haiti on as a project to say, without restoring the environment in Haiti, there's no future for the island of Haiti.
We are constantly paying to these industrialized nations all these billions of dollars for their cheap labor goods. And in the end, we're stuck with them and we can't recycle them. So our problems are the same, our issues are the same. Well, I was fortunate to participate in the ACP Cultural Festival in Dominican Republic, 79 countries, and my exhibit was next to the Haitian. You know, that's why I feel so passionate about Haitian art and Haitian culture, you know? And most of it wasn't paintings, it was recycled stuff, it was recycled material, old tires, that was, old television tubes, you know, multimedia presentation, technology and recycled garbage, you know, and mine was a similar team too. And they were all saying, how does underdeveloped nations get rid of industrial waste? But when they are no longer useful, what do we do with them? They go into our environment, mess up our environment, and a lot of them can be recycled. We can have cultural exchange, especially within CARICOM or within the Caribbean, you know? Letting Haiti help us build our cultural industries. That we have to send our artists to Haiti to study, and the Haitians have to send their artists to St. Vincent and Barbados to study, to go to school. We have to send our students to Haiti. Haitians have to send their students to Dominica. We have to unite. We have to know what is going on. We have to use the social network and build Haiti. Haiti has 9 million people. Can you imagine the size of a marketplace for CARICOM products?
Vincentians actually went into Haiti with the Americans to help to restore Aristide. And I made sure a lot of them went. So not only could help Haiti, but I wanted them to really see some poverty, so they will not use the word in St. Vincent again.
I am hoping that the people of St. Vincent and the Grenadines will go to Haiti as part of a regional grouping to provide technical assistance to work with the Haitian people in the rebuilding of Haiti. Haiti needs a lot of money. They need a lot of skilled persons, but they need a lot of international and regional assistance. And we will provide, hopefully that we can provide manpower to assist in some technical areas. I think, generally speaking, because of the economic downturn throughout the whole of the sub-region or the region, that you're going to have a fair amount of, not hostility, but opposition from people. I want to be very frank about this.
In CARICOM, it's a good thing that we work together to help and work with Haiti. But one, we cannot absorb any Haitian immigration.
We so call ourselves Caribbean countries, but we still set boundaries for one another. For one another. And we are brothers and sisters. The concern that I have is when I have to move one place to the next, as a credible man, as a pastor. Anytime we enter into immigration, they say your Haitian passport. Everybody become red, as if, oh, where you come from? How you reach there?
I don't see how countries in the region can afford not to have to be lending a helping hand to Haitian brothers and sisters whose circumstances are such, and where we can reasonably accommodate a certain number in our family. In the case of St. Vincent, you know, Vincentian family.
You know, there, when I hear about people from Greece and Mexico there in Haiti, helping to rebuild Haiti, we are much closer than Greece. And are we there? Are we there as Vincentians? You know, I felt really great when Minister Thompson went as a doctor and he donated his services. You know, but in terms of people who have we have people here who have the resources to help Haiti. Why aren't they getting on a plane and finding a way to go there and do something? You know, we're right here. There are sisters and brothers.
We had already started a plan for Black History Month events leading up, and it would have been impossible to be planning for Black History Month and nothing includes Haiti then. Take what happened here now in Haiti and start to link closer in terms of cultural activities, youth activities, reaching out to communities, like community for community. In terms of Operation Haiti, we are going to see a connection with Haiti that persons have not seen before.
That's right. Come in.
Toussaint was a mighty man, and to make matters worse, he was black. That is back in the days when black men in his place wasn't a man. But this rebel, he walked through Napoleon, who thought it wasn't very nice.
Issue of how to help Haiti at this time and the fear of any country having to absorb a wave of Haitian immigrants can prove to be very contentious. As for St. Vincent, we have seen a more relaxed attitude by its government in a majority of Vincentian as it relates to Haitian immigrants. There is evidently a very small community of Haitians living here in St. Vincent. Among them, we will find those who are artists, educators, students, ministers, and migrant workers. This very small group of Haitians in St. Vincent have strong ties to their motherland and have been very expressive about the recent earthquake, its impact, and the way forward for Haiti.
Thank you to the Rastafarian organization. Thank you to
all the contributors tonight. And I feel moved. I feel moved by your solid making a difference attitude. You making a difference tonight. You making a difference tonight by sharing with my fellow citizen in Haiti. This commitment that you have made, it has changed your priorities and actions, and that's why you are here tonight. Millions of children, they will see that you have saved them. You starting the process at the right time. It is not too late. And if you wait too late, you will miss the chance to help them. Continue to help Haiti. Continue to help our brothers and sisters. Continue to help those children who are screaming with broken bones. Those children who cannot get access to food. Those people who cannot get access to water. Those people who cannot get access to the basic medical care tonight. I thank you. And it's a dream and a vision that we all share. It will take time. It will take money. It will take hard work. But we are going to add faith to it. And we are going to achieve our dream. One day, our children, one day, our brothers and sisters will be able to stand on their own feet. And as you look back upon your life, the moments that you have really lived are the moments when you have shared with a spirit of love.
When we look at the news reports on TV about what is happening in our homeland, Haiti, it grieves us. With respect to our families, especially our Haitian compatriots, brothers and sisters, it pains us because we are children of the same earth, children of one Creator. It affects me greatly. I have lost a younger brother and nephews, our neighbors, the mother of my brother's wife. They all perish. This has affected our situation. This hurts me deeply too. I have family. Although distant, they have problems, but I cannot do anything to help them. What I can do is what I am doing here, working. I do it, but that is not enough for their needs. In every country, you will find differences among people in how they behave. Really, the majority of Vincentians have shown their support for Haiti because they are grieving with us, and that is shown from those who are working with us right here. The work we are doing here is construction. We are laborers. We came here with OECC. We have worked in Georgetown, including the Rabka Bridge. We also work on the stadium at Arnisville and the library, and we are here now in Arnisville working on this project. We are truly appreciative of the relations between Haiti and the Vincentian government administration of Dr. Ralph Gonzalez. From his support as well as the OECC, the company that permits us to work here as migrants. Having seen Vincentian response, that really gives us the courage to continue working here to help our families while we also help St. Vincent.
And I would say generally, I have gone to Haiti, and as I told you already, I saw the reality. It's pained me. But there's not much as an individual I could do. But if we are connected together, as we are living outside of Haiti, our little effort would create a positive impact on our brothers and sisters in Haiti. One or two or three, whatever we can do to help, it would be very and greatly appreciated.
I feel compelled to do something, even though I'm not in Haiti, even though I'm not on the ground there and seeing the things that are happening, those things are impacting very much on my life and who I am. So if there's any way that I could help, you know, my country, help to uplift my country, I find ways to do it.
What we could do for Haiti, St. Vincent have right now a lot of youths who need some kind of direction in their life. If all the youths get together, right, we could form a linkage with the youths in Haiti and find out in which way we could help.
Operation Haiti will be a reflection of positive things in St. Vincent and in Haiti. When I say this, I mean that our whole goal is that what we could do in Haiti, we're going to do it here as a pilot project. So if we're going to reach out to homeless, we want to reach out to the homeless here. If we're going to reach out to communities that have an environmental problem in Haiti, we want to do the same thing here.
I think that in doing a documentary where you're getting people from all walks of life express their personal views, express their knowledge of Haiti, then perhaps we can get at something that would educate, inform, and maybe change the negative perceptions that people have about Haiti.
Someone once said, no news is good news, and good news doesn't sell. In the case of Haiti, we would like to look at the good things that can happen. Haiti was not totally destroyed. Its human potential is unlimited. There is hope. Although these images of Haiti are rarely shown by the media, we hold on to them in our minds and hearts in the hope that the Haitian-led reconstruction of Haiti will give birth to a fresh new reality.